Our last discussion, I'm delighted to welcome Adaeze Igboemeka.
Thank you very much. Make sure I've got the technology working. Okay, good. There are two areas I'd like to focus on in the response to the report, and I'd just like to say thank you very much to Tradecraft, Asana, for this report. It comes at a really critical time in the aid for trade agenda. We've mentioned the Global Aid for Trade Review coming up, the work that the OECD is doing on results-based management and aid for trade programming. And DFID itself is looking very much at evaluation within the organization and also conducting a portfolio review of all of our trade programming. So really looking at what have been the focus of past aid for trade projects and how effective have they been. So this work really comes in at a good time for us. I'm going to pick up some of the comments that came previously, but what I'll do is focus firstly on the report's recommendations and give a sort of DFID response as far as what progress are we making towards those. And then I'll expand on two of the recommendations. The first one around a more robust approach to evaluation, and I'll talk about DFID's progress so far on that. And then the issue that's come up as far as impact of aid for trade on poverty reduction. And I think what the report is sort of saying is that there needs to be more of a focus on poor as a direct beneficiaries of aid for trade support. So I'll make some comments on that. And then I'll conclude with some where we're going next, DFID, as far as aid for trade and evaluation. So for me, what I took as the key messages from this report were firstly the need for better assessments of impacts and results through more robust aid for trade evaluations. And as we've heard from Will, I mean, it's a complex area, and there's a lot of work going on internationally around methodologies for evaluating aid for trade. A more direct focus on poverty and the poor, and I will come back to the point that Urendra raised, is really addressing poverty through growth, and growth as the main transmission mechanism for that. And then the need for more donor information on aid for trade programs. So I will give a few points on what DFID is doing around that. Okay, so the report recommendations. Firstly, greater transparency of monitoring info and better quality data. DFID has publicly committed to this. We've been one of the lead donors on the IATI, the Aid Transparency Initiative, and have also produced an aid platform. This is an online platform that will be launched that really gives very detailed information around DFID's aid support. But specifically on evaluations and project documentation, which was clearly raised in the report that this is quite difficult to get a hold of online, we have made a public commitment that this work will be available by the 1st of May this year. Now, it's a work in progress. It's a massive amount of data, and there are a lot of technical issues about actually finding the data and making it public, but we have made that commitment by the 1st of May, this type of information will be made available. On the issue of more realistic theories of change and intervention logics, this is a really difficult area, and definitely we've heard, you know, this is a problem amongst all donors, is really getting better at this. DFID has really recognized this as making some real efforts towards changing this. Our revised business case, the business case is the sort of design document that we use for actually getting approval for programs. We've made a change in January where there's an explicit requirement to include a theory of change that is backed up by evidence. So this sort of, you know, these sort of unrealistic leaps of faith, we're not allowed to do that anymore. Basically, we need to have evidence and a really strong base for making these assumptions. So hopefully we'll be able to sort of share some of the experience around that and best practice around getting better at theories of change. conducting and publishing more robust evaluations. Well, I've mentioned the May 1st target as coming up as far as getting all of our evaluations online. But there's the other issue around technical methodologies for evaluating aid for trade. And Will, you made reference to the work that the World Bank has done on looking at impact evaluation on aid for trade programs. DFID has been a part of that work and actually funded that. There's a lot of international debate and discussion around how do you, what are some of the robust methodologies for evaluating trade? It's not as simple as health and education, where did someone access the medicine or is there a child in school? It's there's a lot of debate around methodologies. Increasing direct targeting of aid for trade projects to the poor as direct beneficiaries. Yes, I mean, I think we're all clear that the poverty reduction impact of aid for trade is important, one issue is really around donor coordination and government priorities. So the way DFID will tend to work in a country is a government will present its poverty reduction strategy paper or its national development plan, and our interventions will fit within that. So it's really largely depends on the priorities of the government, our focus. But I'll come back to that because I think there's a few more things to say around that. So currently, DFID's approach to results and evaluation, as I said earlier, really corporately, there's a big push on more and better evaluation across the organization. We're looking at embedding evaluation into the project design with more rigorous and independent evaluation. So it's really about thinking about evaluation at the design stage so that we know what we're measuring and we're taking baseline information, and then when at the end of the project when we come to evaluate it, it's quite clear. Secondly, we're now working on an evaluation strategy for all of our wealth creation projects. So this is really about beefing up DFID's own capacity on evaluation. So this is getting the technical skills and capacity and really providing much more guidance. And this is around using things like impact evaluation, which, yes, it is very expensive, and we need to take a decision as to when we use it. But there is definitely a corporate push to using more impact evaluation in our programming. Thirdly, the new project approval process, which I made reference to the business case just a moment ago. This again started in January. So previously, and the report does highlight this, that there's not a sort of obligation to carry out an evaluation in different projects. Now you need to make a serious case for not doing an evaluation. Any project over 5 million needs to really make a serious consideration of doing an independent evaluation, and if it does not do one, it needs to give a justification as to why it hasn't. So there's going to be a lot more focus on independent evaluation. And then lastly, on aid for trade specifically and the aid for trade M&E framework, I said DFID doesn't have one. In the sense of the report, and we worked with Sana on this, we had an aid for trade strategy from 2008 to 2013, which came in with the previous administration. That was very much a sort of political strategic document that was really trying to give much more profile to aid for trade, and it was an umbrella strategy that sort of went across the organization. It was a strategy that cross-cutted many units across DFID, many different strategies, many different policies. So there was really shared accountabilities with the programs within that. So we worked with Sana to try to look at, can we come up with an M&E framework for this strategy? And we went into phase one, and phase one was really about what needs to be done to create an M&E framework for our aid for trade. Because of the sort of shared nature of our programs, that we're very decentralized, and so a lot of the programs are sort of run and managed from the country level, we decided it wasn't feasible to have one overarching accountability framework for aid for trade. That said, I'll move on to the next one. That said, I'll say a bit about how we are approaching aid for trade and results within DFID. this very much comes within the context of the bilateral and multilateral aid reviews that happened in 2010. And this really triggered a new approach to results and value for money across DFID. The report talks about this process, but I'll just say quickly a few things about that. The outcome of that was that DFID is very much focused on countries, and what we did was we prioritized and we said we're only going to work in 27 countries, and then we came out with a number of thematic pillars which we would focus on, and that's where we would say we were going to deliver results. So aid for trade comes under the wealth creation pillar, and so there was a results offer for each theme. With very clear indicators. So what we have is a wealth creation pillar with trade-related results indicators. So I'm just going to show some examples of that here. So this is the wealth creation pillar and the aid for trade results we have within that. So what I've done is I've highlighted how many country plans have trade and transport headline results. So we have 12 country programs that have identified trade as they're going to deliver clear results on that, and I've sort of broken them down by theme. So trade facilitation, road building, revenue collection. And then underneath that, so those are sort of the overarching results. Underneath that, we have identified our trade-related indicators that would tell us have we met these results or not. So there are 77 of those across the organization, across all of DFID's country programs, and I've broken them down just to illustrate. But we've got things like trade facilitation, east across borders. Tax administration, agriculture, these are all identified indicators that show have we met the results that we've said we're going to on aid for trade. And I'll just show next some of the, I've shown here some of the headline results so you can see specifically what some of these look like. So I've shown a couple from Africa. We've got Southern Africa, Burundi, DRC, and if you take a look at those, they are very much outcome indicators. So we've got border crossings in the tripartite area in Africa, that's Southern and Eastern Africa. The crossing times have cut by 50%. 4 million additional people benefiting directly from improved cross-border trade. And then another one, as an example, 1,700 additional kilometers of road built. So these are, this gives you an idea of the types of results that we've committed to achieving, and the year by which we'll achieve them. Now, from some of those indicators I'd shown you, there weren't very many, and on the trade related indicators, there were not very many that were that looked directly at the poor as beneficiaries. And this is because we really look at trade as a means to an end. So it's going back to Urendra's point, is that we see trade as really a driver for economic growth, and that's the main transmission for reducing poverty in a systematic way. So coming back to the question around should we look at the poor as direct beneficiaries of aid for trade, just a few points here on that. Most DFID aid for trade interventions are about building institutional capacity and investment climate. So really, if we look at the definition of aid for trade, the global agenda, it's very much about increasing trade levels in countries, in regions. And really what the evidence shows is that, you know, there are three things that will increase trade. Infrastructure, investment climate. So can a company easily, can businesses set themselves up? Can foreign businesses come and set themselves up? And trade facilitation. Do your borders work? Is there a huge bureaucracy, customs, etc.? So those tend to be the areas where we focus DFID as far as our aid for trade interventions. We see these as more important for long-term economic development. And there's a focus on systemic issues. So it's really about getting ministries to function more effectively, really getting the enabling environment in place for being able to trade. So I've put some examples of some of our big major aid for trade programs in DFID, and you'll see they're these types of programs. So Trademark East Africa, Trademark Southern Africa, big regional programs spending about, you know, close to 100 million a year on trade facilitation, infrastructure, those types of things. The South Asia Trade and Investment Program, again working in India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and looking at trade facilitation across the region, so getting the borders to work more effectively. And just a last example, the Trade Advocacy Fund, which is about helping governments to negotiate to negotiate better trade agreements. And again, the poverty impact is indirect, and we're very clear about this. And this is why when you look at a lot of our programs, you will see poverty reduction at the impact or goal level rather than at the outcome level. Because if the assumption is, and there's a lot of evidence to support it, that if a country is able to trade more, it will grow, that will create jobs, that will increase incomes, and then lead to poverty reduction. That's a very long results chain, so we don't tend to try to make a direct attribution to fixing the customs administration. We don't tend to assess the direct poverty reduction impact on that. It's just not. You can't do that robustly. It's not. We don't have enough information to do it. I think lastly, what I'd like to say on that is about country contacts, and I spoke about that earlier. And I guess it's this issue about. You know, should we have more programs that are directly targeting the poor? And again, it's very important to look at country context and other interventions that are happening in the country. So it's very much about what the government's policy priorities are and how our aid fits into that. And then thinking about what other donors are doing and how do we coordinate with that. I'm not trying to say that you know, we shouldn't have programs that directly target the poor, because we do. DFID has a range of large major programs that focus on rural livelihoods, so jobs for poor people, microfinance, social assistance, social safety nets. So the question is really, is aid for trade the best instrument for targeting the poor, or are there other more direct, more effective means that we have, you know, that we can really look at the evidence of direct impact? Just to give an example, I said that we tend to work with the governments and what their policy priorities are. Trademark East Africa, Trademark Southern Africa, these are our major sort of flagship aid for trade programs. And those were very much developed by working with the regional economic communities in Eastern and Southern Africa, the national governments. And really, there's a big push right now in Africa around regional integration and working towards a free trade area in Southern and Eastern Africa. And so that's why you'll see most of our trade programs are focusing on those types of interventions. Regional integration, getting borders to work, so trucks cross borders more quickly. These are how we've prioritized our aid for trade work. Sorry,
thank you very much. No.
Sorry, one last slide.
Sorry, I think you were pausing.
Yeah. just to sort of sum up what next on aid for trade monitoring and evaluation. So I showed the table with the different indicators and the countries and the years. So really, you know, we've set that out. We set that out in 2010. And so now the next point is for the regional and country programs to conduct robust evaluations to measure their performance against these results that they've said that they're going to achieve. This isn't easy. I mean, we've talked about some of the technical issues around measuring impact. So therefore, this cross-organization agenda on evaluation methodologies, on technical capacity, and results. And just to highlight a couple of the challenges for us around measuring some of this, DFID spends £1 billion a year on aid for trade. But a lot of it is through multilaterals. Two-thirds of it is through multilaterals. So very hard for us to, we have to work with the multilaterals for them in turn to evaluate more effectively. So that's why we see evaluation and aid for trade, M&E, as a sort of international agenda. It's not just about DFID's bilateral program, but about the multilaterals. Lastly, impact indicators. So going up to the next level from the outcome to the impact or goal level, it's, you know, we were saying the evidence and being robust in showing the direct attribution is very difficult. Another issue is that we've now taken a very country-focused approach. So all evaluation will be done at the country level. So there is an issue about how do we aggregate results, because you know, it's sometimes it's comparing apples and oranges, comparing Rwanda to Mozambique, for example. And really, again, around attribution, aid for trade programs often work on the, you know, we tend to work on the systemic issue, so we're not the only actor in that space. So it's very difficult for us to say this has been the direct result of our intervention. But what we're trying to do is make sure that we are moving in the right direction, so we can say that this program made a contribution to this outcome. So this is why there's a need for sort of comparable indicators across donor and partner country aid for trade efforts. And I know the OECD has been doing some work on that, is looking at what are some common indicators for aid for trade, so that we cannot, so if we're all sort of, if we're all working on a common agenda, we can say a bit more about attribution, and that we're moving in the right direction of travel. Thank you very much.